Staples like wheat, maize, and rice feed the world, providing nearly half the calories we eat. But in many regions, these crops and our access to them are under threat.
There's definitely an urgency to find alternatives to the current food systems, especially in the current context that we're in now, where you've had supply chains disrupted by COVID, where you have the Ukraine-Russia war, which has reduced the amount of wheat available, where you have climate change, making it more difficult to access water sources.
Current global conditions have created the worst food security crisis in West Africa for a decade. And nearly 40 million people in the Sahel region, a semi-arid belt across North Africa, are now facing hunger. But fonio, a small grain native to that region, has the potential to help.
In many ways, fonio is the crop of the future, but it's unable to live to that potential because of how much it's been neglected in the past. It tastes like couscous, but what it has over couscous is that it's gluten-free, it's easy to digest, it's protein-rich, anti-glycemic, which means that it helps fight diabetes, and it's also very filling.
But most importantly, fonio is drought-resistant and can grow in poor soil. It only grows in the Sahel region and a belt of savanna below it. It's cultivated mainly for sustenance in lean times by local communities, like the nomadic Fulani.
Fulani is really one of the predominant ethnic groups in the Sahel. Chef Fatmata Binta is from Sierra Leone and based in Ghana. And so she's of that ethnicity. She was a refugee and ate fonio to survive with her family.
I want to decolonize African cuisine because the questions I was asking myself when I was in culinary school was, why am I cooking the food I didn't grow up eating? It didn't make sense to me also why food should travel miles to come to my kitchen before I serve it to someone.
After going to culinary school in Kenya and working at top hotels in Accra, Chef Fatmata Binta toured the world with a pop-up restaurant that gave others a chance to taste her culture with a focus on fonio.
It's an ancient grain. It has been around for a very long time. We believe over 7,000 years. It's very easy to grow. So if you think about a sustainable grain, that's the first grain that will come to mind for me. You don't need to plow the land too much to grow it. And it's a tiny grain, like the size of sand.
The size of the fonio grains is a problem. Being so small and wrapped in a husk that has to be removed before it's eaten makes it extremely hard and tedious to process. And in most places, the processing hasn't changed for millennia. It starts with separating the grain from the stem.
The women will stomp on it while they are singing and dancing. That's their way of also, you know, having that community sisterhood bonding. They will try to get the sand out of the fonio after stomping. And then they will pound it, they will toast it. It takes like a week or two to process.
Technological innovation is a must if fonio's ever to be a serious contender as a crop of the future. There are only 700,000 tons of it produced annually, compared to over 700 million tons of wheat. About 75% of all fonio comes from Guinea.
At a point, the former president of Guinea, President Alpha Condé, who was actually deposed in a coup, became a big advocate for fonio. He used to travel to neighboring countries on diplomatic missions and carry a bag of fonio to give to his counterparts because he recognized that there was an export market and that he could earn foreign currency by exporting fonio, and so there was a push to mechanize fonio. About a dozen countries can grow fonio, but in Guinea, they actually have quite a few mills, which is not the case for the other countries.
Those machines are very helpful because it helps us to increase our productivity before the machine. For the production of 1 ton, we can take 3 weeks. Now that we have the machine, we can just make 3 days or 4 days.
But even mills in Guinea's capital, Conakry, haven't mechanized the entire process. And so dehusking often still happens the traditional way.
Fonio's kind of got a reputation in Western media as a superfood that had this quinoa potential, but it hasn't really taken off. There is not enough fonio being grown, at least at a commercial level, and there's not enough processing facility. Fonio is actually considered a neglected and underutilized crop species. That's actually a scientific category, which is also called an orphan crop, which means it's been an under-researched crop.
More research could help improve yields and bring the production process into the 21st century. But to gain more traction, ambassadors like Chef Binta are crucial to spreading the word about fonio's potential.
There's something so powerful about food, and I believe it can break down barriers. It's a bridge. I get to collaborate a lot with Michelin star chefs. I will send them fonio and then challenge them to create something, because I believe that's how you spark conversation, and that's how you educate people and expose it to the world.
Local exposure is also crucial. Even though fonio grows in northern Ghana, in the region's biggest city there, Tamale, the grain is nowhere to be found.
It's been so much a grain that's been kept for farmer households. But even though I describe it as a farmer crop, it's actually very expensive to buy fonio. It's about 8 times more expensive than rice, than the same quantity of rice. And that's why if you want to buy it as an outsider, it's actually very expensive. It's a ceremonial meal. The idea is that if there's a commercialization of fonio, what would also happen is that the cost of fonio would go down, but there needs to be a value chain for fonio, for there to be more players, more manufacturers, more people who grow it. If you don't change mindsets quickly and bring investments, people are actually going to forget the skill because it's only traditional, and there needs to be a point where people, both researchers, industry, governments, decide that they need to invest in this as a real solution.
Chef Binta is one of many who are taking fonio seriously. So seriously, in fact, she's willing to bet her own livelihood on it. She's now moving to Tamale to work directly with farmers and try to build the value chain from the ground up.
Now spend days with the locals, the keepers of the authentic recipes. These women take time to teach me. They're passing down knowledge. They're passing down sustainable traditions. And it didn't feel right to walk away, go back to my kitchen and not recognize what they are going through. So I wanted to collaborate with them in a more meaningful way. So the main goal is to partner with women who are growing fonio already in the north of Ghana. And we'll have a center where we'll process, we'll package, and then we distribute locally and internationally. And I believe we have to start locally, because we have to place value first locally, and then we can scale it.